Good afternoon. Welcome to MAPI's webinar on material reuse. Thanks for taking time out today to join us. My name is Maria Negron-Nibe, and I'm a council director here at MAPI. Across the next hour, we're going to be talking about three things: the benefits of the circular economy, how material reuse is taking place today, and how Pathways 21's material marketplace can help manufacturers find opportunities in this space. I'm joined today by Andy Mangan, the founder of and president of Pathway 21. Pathway 21 is a company that enables business-to-business industrial reuse through the award-winning materials marketplace software platform, which supports a culture shift to a circular closed-loop economy. The material marketplace is something Andy has been working on passionately for over the last 20 years, and it's driven by experts in this field, himself among them, and over the next period of time, he will be taking us through that. Before I hand over the reins to Andy, I just want to mention a few things on logistics. First, the webinar is being recorded, and this is for replay purposes. Anyone on your team will be able to listen to it later, and everyone will receive the replay link and follow-up from today's session. Right now, everyone is in listen-only mode. If you're on the phone, I just ask that you double-check and mute your line. There will be chances to ask questions on the call, so if you can please submit those during the course of the call. There is a chat box. You can find that on the bottom of the webinar navigation box on the right-hand side of your computer screen. If you don't see the box, it's probably minimized, so look for a vertical rectangle at the top of your screen. Click on the top set of arrows to open the navigation box. At that point, you should see the chat box. Just write in your question and send it to us. We'll hold general questions until the end, and then Andy will go through those. So please don't hesitate to submit them as they pop up. We have allotted enough time for questions, we hope, but if in the interest of time we're running close to the end of the hour, we will combine questions, but we will try to get to as many as we can. And with that, I will turn things over to Andy.
Terrific, Maria. Thank you so much and welcome everybody. Glad to be here today with you. I'm going to go through about a dozen slides here and then get into the questions and hear from you all. A little bit for just another background about Pathway 21. It is a company. It's a that was spun off of the United States Business Council for Sustainable Development, which is a coalition of companies that's been working since the early 90s to try to identify solutions to the sustainable development challenges we all face. And this material reuse concepts was one early identified in the mid 90s. So yeah, 20 plus years we've been working on it. And over those years, we've learned quite a bit. And we created this new company because the activities were beginning to really gain momentum in the last 3 or 4 years. So it was natural to create this new entity as we go down that path. Some of the reasons why we're seeing accelerated interest in reuse, material reuse, is here's one example. Waste as a concept is beginning to be reconsidered. What is waste and why is it that, why do we think of it in that way? So if, as a manufacturer, what is left after your products leave the factory or facility may no longer be of use to you all, but could well be of interest to other manufacturers and or other architects, builders, etc. So there's a lot of opportunity there. How do you get those connections? How do you make those and drive toward valuable reuse opportunities is what this materials marketplace is really all about. And there is a very large amount of material out there that is industrial material left over after the products are out. Just imagining a automaker that might have thousands of material streams, but all different organizations have those. The challenge has been, how do you turn what is no longer of value to you into something of value and avoid just having it carted off to the landfill and or to be reused through a broker or others that you don't get to benefit from. So the last point on here, though, is an interesting one for those of you who are interested in carbon reduction. The US EPA has estimated that material use is associated with 42% of greenhouse gas emissions. And so there's some opportunity here to reduce greenhouse emission footprints and or potentially, as we're working on a pilot to show how we could gain greenhouse gas credit through material reuse. That's to be determined in the future, but an opportunity. So just another aspect of this is Maria mentioned the circular economy, and that's the kind of the theme of this webinar. What is it? Well, it's something that is the idea of shifting away from the linear approach where you take your materials, make your products, and the waste goes elsewhere, and you stay focused very narrowly on those products. But what is, so can we shift that to create an additional value from your process out of those leftover materials, as we've talked about? So that's the basics, part of the basis for this circular economy concept. Keep materials in use as long as possible. Use the technology that we have to help identify and make the connections that make sense and can save or make money for companies and communities, and try to avoid waste as a concept and look for 100% product. That's the ultimate goal. So this concept is really gaining momentum. It really has a strong momentum in Europe, where the European Union has formally endorsed this as one of its strategic growth opportunities, and is putting half a billion euros into supporting activities like the materials marketplace and others to help establish this kind of a transition from the linear to the circular. Here in the U.S., things are moving, and we're seeing real opportunities happening, and we're also working in Asia. So there's a lot of opportunity. It's a global trend, and partially driven by market realities and incremental market advantage through more effective, efficient use of materials. But as the economy grows globally into the future, more and more materials will be used, and a potential opportunity there to avoid disruption if different things happen unexpectedly, natural or otherwise. If you can, the more you can diversify and create resilience, the better. And turning a liability into an asset is of great interest to all companies. And showing how you can do that is what we think the technology that we have today can really help unleash those opportunities. One other aspect of this as a benchmark is the potential economic value. This $1 trillion number is from the World Economic Forum, which was put together by Accenture and McKinsey. Both were involved in these analyses that from a global level, we're looking at economic benefit in material savings of $1 trillion globally. So as I said, that looking at this approach from a feedstock side, waste disposal cost and greenhouse gas emissions, and or taking a material that could qualify as a input into your products is something that's being examined by R&D groups within companies and or product development organizations. I'll give you a few examples, but as I said, it's happened. This kind of activity, as you all probably are aware, is happening globally. This is just a few of the brands that we've worked with over the last 20 plus years and that are engaged. There are many, many more, but it's all these different industries, not just one, but it's all different businesses, large, medium, and small, and some can engage in new ways through this interchange of materials and create new business relationships that are sometimes unexpected. That is another way that this platform, this software platform, the materials marketplace can help. It's very similar to it's called a multi-sided platform is the technology term for it, but it's just like Amazon or eBay or any other kind of web-based system that has your data flows in and you can transact business in the, and all different both users, suppliers, government can engage through it, and those with technological or other solutions, logistics, all different sorts, can participate and help make these transactions happen through this kind of a platform that that is the materials marketplace. It's also something a big difference with this and some of these others is it is a facilitated marketplace. So that means our team at Pathway 21 helps analyze all of these materials, thousands of different streams, and connects those where we see opportunities, either from our experience or we have a network of expert partners, academic, technical, technological, all of the different legal, and we are able to harness those and help drive connections and rather quickly determine whether there's a viability or not, and if so, move to the next stage, which might be trade sharing, samples. But you go down that path, and we're here to help facilitate it. It's like a wizard in a way. Some programs, but that currently is largely done by a team of people that are part of this marketplace. But it's increasingly being automated, and it lends itself to that kind of automation in the future. So that's where it's headed. We're currently this marketplace concept the platform is deployed regionally or geographically. We have marketplaces at the state level in Ohio, Tennessee, and Michigan. Each of those three states has partnered with us. So that's the State Economic Development Corporation and the State Environmental Commission. At the highest levels have joined forces with us to make this available to companies in those three states. We're working with about another dozen states, both out in the Rocky Mountain area and on the Atlantic coast in the US, Chesapeake Bay area, and down in the Gulf Coast. But all of these states are supporting the establishment of this marketplace with both resources and policy support. So if we, through this program, this platform, we can show a material reuse that is not happening, but should be because it's got all the value and attributes and does not produce environmental harm, but is being held up by some regulatory structure that may not be appropriate today, we can work with the regulators on that. They're very interested in trying to help accelerate this kind of activity. We also have a partnership with an organization that represents the 50 state environment commissioners. It's called the Environmental Council of the States, or ECOS, and we're working with ECOS and the commissioners to help bring this to all 50 states. So we're starting with these three. There are many more coming, and the actual platform itself is a separate entity, but that is being supported by the state. So it's a great public-private partnership in that way. We also have at the city level, the city of Austin, which is where the Business Council and Platform Pathway 21 are headquartered. The city got was an early adopter of this and has been sponsoring this marketplace in Austin for the last 5 years. And we're an early adopter, as was at the U.S. level. So national level, we launched a marketplace platform in with about 25 companies in and within a relatively short period, 3 months or so, there were 2 million tons of materials up there from all different companies. Most of those were large multinationals, but that global national level platform is growing and is something that we're applying all as well in Europe with the Republic of Turkey, sponsored by the European Development Bank. So we've got a variety of supporters, and if you all are interested in at the U.S. at facilities across the country, this is an opportunity to work with us and get those facilities engaged in this kind of an activity. We have over 1,000 companies or participating sites, mostly different companies, but and we are from both public and private survey results, the materials marketplace is out ahead, and there aren't a lot of competitors out there at this point. We're working with this internationally in Israel and in Vietnam right now, in addition to Turkey. So there's quite a bit of engagement. Just to tell you how it actually works, a company will sign up, go to the website, and will say for the U.S. marketplace or any of the others, any of those states or even the international. And there's a place where you can join. And when you join, there's no cost. It's really designed to be cost-free until you realize a valuable opportunity is there to actually take materials and transact, have a transaction. And then just like in eBay, we take the marketplace takes a transaction fee from that. That's the way it works. So there's no charge, no cost. What you do need to do is upload your data about your materials onto the marketplace, and we will help you with that. But and that's an easy way, it's fairly easy to do that. And then we begin to look through all of the different opportunities that are possible and help start connecting you with other possibilities that are for reuse and or aggregation or working through all the elements that might be needed to either process, transport, or otherwise deal with the material so it can actually be transaction can occur. We've got multiple, it's a multi-sided platform. So we have multiple kind of user groups. One is the companies that actually put the materials up on the marketplace. Another is there are a lot of companies that are interested in using, finding materials. And then there's a third group that is we call solution providers, or those are companies that might have technologies or systems or logistical solutions that are needed to help achieve the objective of reuse. There's R&D systems that are involved, or there are testing companies. All of the different elements you might need are going to be in the marketplace, and so it's the overall approach and the idea. Then the fourth one is the government. So the governments really support this kind of approach. They really like the idea of reusing materials rather than disposing of them in any way, and want to help modernize the whole waste management system, which is really the way it's structured now is based on 100 years of industrial and manufacturing activities that is that linear approach, and they're very supportive of moving to the circular approach, which is a real advantage for companies and a real opportunity to work with the government in ways that we haven't been able to necessarily in the past. But that's a great common objective. So governments are also participating in this. We have just to touch on some of the key platform features. It's an ease of use interface for putting what you might have up there and seeing how, where, and whether there might be some interest in that material. It's also something that when you do reach a agreement on something that's viable and makes sense, there the marketplace includes a transaction engine that will take you through all of the different steps to transaction, including making sure that any payment doesn't happen until there's total satisfaction on both sides. So we use the same transaction structure that Amazon and eBay and these other companies use. So it's a reliable and proven approach. As I mentioned earlier, the underlying software architecture is designed to become increasingly automated in the future for scalability. So as we're growing and we scale, that's built into the system. It is early now. It's been up and running since 2015, when it did win a global circulars award over in Davos at the World Economic Forum, which since then it's really been gaining a lot of traction. So, and then this analytics data mining concept is part of it, because we're going to be generating a lot of new data that isn't available right now, both for individual companies, but also in aggregate for the governments and the states. And there's quite a bit of interest in that side of things, and where and how we can make use of this data is something of high value. So those are the key elements, the transaction fees that I mentioned. They're, just to go over it again, this is the business model. There's no participation fee. There's also something that we're based on savings or disposal costs is how we calculate the transaction fees. It's, as you can see, 10 to 15% based on the size and type of transaction. You only pay when the material is actually exchanged. And it's something that allows the marketplace to be stable and grow. So that's the current model. And as I said, here's just a quick display of where we're operating here in the US, Tennessee, Ohio, Michigan, Minnesota. We're in discussions with right now and have been for the last 6 months. So it's looking pretty good for Minnesota in the near future. In the Rocky Mountains, we're working with in a multi-state platform. It would be, we're talking with Colorado, Utah, Wyoming, Montana, and Nebraska, which would all join in a marketplace there. And then I mentioned the Chesapeake Bay, that's Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, Virginia, and West Virginia. So we're trying to create these across the country, and the first few states were the state specific, but we're open to trying to bring in multi-state groups, which is of interest to these states. So, and then the Southwest, both Louisiana and Oklahoma, are really interested in getting something going, and we're in discussions with Texas. So those are, that's kind of the market pipeline and the existing marketplaces. If you are, just a reminder, if you're in companies that sign up to be in the U.S. marketplace, gain access to all of these state marketplaces. And so it's really designed for those companies that have multiple facilities across the country. Just to wind up, really, it's a few comments by some of the different leader groups. This Maddie Stanislaus, over here on the left is with the World Economic Forum. He also was in charge of the at US EPA the waste management side of the EPA for 8 years under President Obama, and when he left, he joined the World Economic Forum. He was really instrumental in helping to establish a shift in culture at EPA to focused on sustainable materials management was his concept, and that's so he's a big supporter and is on our advisory board. In the middle here is John Bradburn, who worked with General Motors for close to 40 years on much of which was on material reuse globally. He was their global manager of waste reduction, and GM is a leader in that among all companies. It has over close to 150 facilities that are landfill free, and he's the one who's responsible for establishing those, along with all his colleagues at these different facilities. But he's now part of Pathway 21. He left, he retired from General Motors earlier this year and joined our company. And then this third one is Craig Butler, who heads up the Ohio EPA and was one of the first to really say this is something critical and needed in Ohio. And Ohio is, we've been running this marketplace in Ohio for about a year now. Tennessee started back in the fall of last year, and Michigan is just getting started right now. So Craig is an example of the kind of state level government leaders that are supportive of this. There's not a lot of dissent. There's a lot of common agreement that this is something they want to work with the private sector on to accelerate. They in a sense, they don't really know how or what to do. So there's a great opportunity, and we have a materials leadership council with five state leaders, environment commission leaders, and five company leaders, and we're able to use that to help create communication back and forth in the bigger picture on incentives and other things like that would be structural future opportunities. So here's myself. I want to thank everybody for joining today, and really would love to see you. If this sounds of interest, would love to hear from you and get you involved in either at the state level or the U.S. marketplace, or if you have operations in some of these countries. Right now we're working, as I said, Vietnam, Israel, and Turkey are the three areas that we're engaged in at different stages. But Turkey is the farthest along. We've been working there for about 2 years. Maria, I think that's the end. That's the last slide. I'd love to hear if there are some questions.
Yes, we actually do have some questions. So thank you, Andy. We're going to stop there to take some questions. A quick reminder to use the chat box to submit those questions. The chat box is at the bottom of the webinar navigation box on the right-hand side of the computer screen. If you don't see it, it could be minimized. So look for the vertical rectangle at the top of your screen. Click the top set of arrows to open the navigation box, and you should see the chat box at the bottom. Write in the question and send it in, and we'll just get started with some of the questions we've already received. So to kick it off, Andy, how is compliance with RCRA regulations ensured?
Yeah, so compliance with RCRA is the responsibility of the companies. What we do is help connect the companies with new materials, but the due diligence on whether and how that would work under RCRA is a responsibility typically of the companies engaged. We are there to help and provide legal analysis. So we have law firms that are working with us that have 30 years of RCRA experience that we can engage. So that's available. Up to this point, most of the companies that we've worked with have that compliance built into their activities. So what happens is there's a new opportunity that emerges and wow, this looks good, but let's make sure that we'd be compliant under RCRA. So that's basically the approach.
Okay. To get started, you know, how would you recommend that a company get started? Who should be involved? Should it be someone who is looking to get rid of materials? Is it looking for someone to, you know, partner up? Should it be someone who can provide logistics, perhaps capabilities? What would you recommend as a starting point for companies?
Yeah, well, someone who knows or has a sense of what the materials are that might be of highest value to the company, to find both to convert from flowing into a waste down into a waste process in, and also that may you have an interest to other company, other users potentially. So that would be one. Someone who could actually, who would know about those materials would be good and be able to help get those onto the system. We've got purchasing folks involved from companies. We have operations, mostly operations level people. There are those who really are responsible for that side of the business. That's the main connection point for us typically. Oftentimes or sometimes companies aren't that have that split among different roles, so there may have to be more than one. But so for example, in an auto company, we've got the purchasing side and the disposal side involved, and also say the metals, those responsible for metals, those responsible for packaging materials, those responsible for other material flows like chemicals and things like that. Those are all engaged with multiple automotive companies, and or we've got aeronautical, we've got construction related companies. There are chemical companies. There's also agricultural companies that are involved. So, but those would be the kinds of folks we get engaged. And then as we go down the path, logistics will definitely be important. But we'll be able to work with them, with you all, on all of those. And but that's the starting point. Really, it's important to get the materials in this so that we can start churning and determining where and how there might be a good fit.
Okay. Kind of again on the issue of participation, if this, you know, you mentioned several states that are participating. If the state that a company is headquartered in or operates in isn't one of those listed, can a company still participate?
Absolutely, yeah. The interesting thing here is the states are so interested in this and wanting to make it available that they're stepping up and sponsoring us to do it in those states. So that's why we're doing it there, and which means they're, in a sense, funding the program for the first 2 years. That's really the design. So get them. They'll support the establishment like we're doing right now in Michigan of the marketplace and cover all the cost of standing it up and getting it running. And the goal is by the time we hit 2 years, we'd have well over 1,000 companies participating, and there'd be enough transaction activity going to continue to run it without any support. But they're like a Kickstarter supporter right now, investor in a sense. So that's of interest to these other states too. As I said, groupings of states are kind of, well, let's do it, but we're not big enough to do it by ourselves. Let's do it with a group of states. So that's why we're doing that kind of thing. But any company, really, any company that's operating in either those states that are where we're already have these marketplace in place can participate. And it's really going to go to the website, which is easy to find, Ohio Materials Marketplace, U.S. Materials Marketplace, or any of the other states, and there's, as I said, there's a place to join up on the upper right, typically, or at the end of the, at one of the pages, and you can get involved, and then you'll be in and start moving. The other thing that's interesting is these other states. If you're headquartered in a state and you think it, this might be of interest, we do have direct link through ECOS with the state environment commissioners. So that's what's happening in the Chesapeake Bay region, for instance. We're working with the state environment commissioners and actually there are others, the economic development corporations, even the legislatures are expressing interest in this kind of as an economic development strategy. New England is another area we haven't gone to yet, but we've had inquiries from different states up there, and New England would be a natural grouping of states. There's a the US EPA regional administrator that just took over there 6 months ago or so was, prior to that, the executive director at ECOS, the Environmental Council of States, and she knows all about it and is a big supporter. EPA in general is a big supporter of this as well, but they don't know how to do it. They need the business sector to come in and set it up and actually get moving and get to start participating. What they want to do is they're asking, how can we help? How can we get out of the way? Or how can we move this forward? So in ways, of course, that that cover their environmental responsibilities, but also that open the door to greater reuse opportunities.
So for those companies, say in the Northeast, where there isn't the built-in network quite yet, but it looks like it's growing and there's interest, what can those companies do to perhaps help lay the pathwork to getting this on board if they're interested?
Yeah, that's a great opportunity. We would love to hear from you if that's the case, and because we will go then to that region, and we would want to work with you to have you there when we're engaging with the state leadership and say, you know, this to us makes a lot of sense. For example, in Michigan, we had close to 100 companies that were telling the state, but when they did a couple of things. They did a survey of 12,000 companies in Michigan initially and found this concept was the most of the greatest interest in two companies in Michigan in terms of material reuse. And so that out of that came, there were about 100 companies that really said, we're there to help, but we really want to make it happen. A lot of automotive, but also different industries. So if we go to New England, we would love to, we'll probably do that here in the maybe this summer, and we'll meet with the state commissioners either online, like we're doing now. We had set up a webinar. We'd have the five or six commissioners on there, and we'd talk about this as concept. We'd probably have the US EPA regional administrator on, and we would love to have some companies that are there, that are operating there, also engaged in that conversation, and that will help really help in the establishment of a state supported marketplace.
Okay. One question we have here is, how do you measure the effectiveness of the reuse program? Do you have any tools for that?
Yeah, we measure it both, well, of course, on the financial side in terms of transaction values, and that's a requirement for us in that business model because that's how we make money and generate revenue for the company. So that's one that we're closely measuring, but also we're keeping track and reporting to the companies that are involved on a variety of environmental metrics. Definitely, of course, the landfill reduction and related benefits like the greenhouse gas reduction or carbon reduction values we're working on. We are working on a pilot right now with a number of companies that would demonstrate the energy savings through reuse and subsequent carbon savings, and tracking those, the goal of which is to show how and why that should be something that would be could qualify as a carbon credit. That's something we're working on in California right now. But also we could measure any number of environmental factors, air emissions as well. So and then we're measuring the from the social side, job creation related to this and or job retention. And those are two that are great interest to the economic development corporations. And so, and of course, with this this most recent issue with the China Sword program, which is the program where China is made a decision no longer to accept certain material flows that it had been, a variety of commodities. They're now, that's causing a lot of disruption here in the U.S. and elsewhere around the world. But in terms of what do you do with all that stuff, it's the whole traditional recycling markets are being thrown into a bit of a chaos because there's many times more now than they had just a few months ago before this Chinese new Chinese policy went into effect. But that also is creating opportunity for and a real reason for these states to try to help accelerate ways to reuse that material, whether it's different types of plastics. That's a different kind of a commodity focused effort, but that's something that's happening as well. So all of those are measurable, and we will report to the individual companies, but also in aggregate to the states.
Okay. Any programs for U.S. wooden pallets and Chinese pallets? I mean, it sounds like your marketplace takes almost or all materials. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, it's pretty fair to say. I mean, there are certain really dangerous ones that might not be qualified, but sure. I mean, typically, and including there's maybe a small percentage, but hazardous materials are that's an opportunity as well. But of course, but all of it can be examined in this context. And not to say we're going to find reuse for everything, but this is in a way, it's like expanding the analysis from either your own companies or even your industry to much broader cross industry and not just narrow geography, but all across geographies. And you have to take into account logistics and the economics, of course, but this way we can broaden out and can have continuous kind of cascading opportunities where you new and unrealized opportunities. So I think the growth as this grows, and it is growing, will be increasing opportunities for non-traditional reuse of materials that aren't happening right now. But some of the tier one companies that are supplying the automakers, for example, are now looking at using different materials that, of course, will help with lightweighting which is a big deal for automakers, but also reduce costs because you're reusing a material, whether that's a plastic or even some of those thermosets are coming through there. So there's a lot of interesting possibilities there. So there's some near-term opportunities to explore, and then some mid and longer term as well.
Okay. Well, I think that's all the questions we have for now. If any other questions are submitted after we conclude the webinar today, I will reach out to you, Andy, and we can see if we can get those answered after the fact, if that's okay with you.
That sounds great, Maria. Thank you, and thank everybody for joining today.
Okay, well, before wrapping up, I'd like to thank you on behalf of MAPI, Andy, for joining us to talk about the materials marketplace today. I hope everyone on the line today found the session thought-provoking. This webinar has been recorded, and we will let you know as soon as the link to the slides and the recording is posted on the MAPI website, you will actually receive an email. If you would like to connect on this topic further, you can contact myself or Andy, or join us in further in-person discussion September 27th and 28th in Houston at our MAPI Sustainability Council meeting. And also, I'd like to ask you to stay on the line for one more minute so that you can answer two questions about today's session. We take your feedback very seriously, and I appreciate you letting us know how valuable you found the webinar and any thoughts on future webinars as well. If you have any questions again, please don't hesitate to contact me, and thank you, and have a great day.